So hello, welcome to this webinar about Dutch education system. And towards the end, I will also explain a bit about the Corona developments. We had a press conference again this evening, about 1.5 hours ago, so the update is still fresh. Maybe before we start, it would be good to know who you are. Are you already living in the Netherlands? Do you still live abroad? Do you have any questions already? Anything that you want to find out at the moment? How old are your children? So just give me an idea of who's there. I see some people coming in. So hello, Angelina. I hope I pronounced your name correctly. Karen, Carol, Jennifer, Gashap. So all, thank you for signing up. I'll move to the presentation and we'll take it from there. So first, a little bit about New2NL. Then we'll move on to the subject of preschool. Then we'll make a comparison between the Dutch and the international schools. After that, we'll zoom in into the Dutch schools because that's rather complicated. So I'll explain how a Dutch primary school works. Maybe you've already heard that there's a lot of different philosophies that a lot of schools are based on. So we'll talk a little bit about that as well. Tell you how the testing works, especially in group 8, the last year of primary school. We'll zoom in a little bit on the levels of secondary education. I'm planning on giving a separate webinar about the secondary schools, so then we'll talk more in detail about that. A question I get asked a lot is, what makes a good school? Well, you'll see that really depends on your situation and your family and your wishes and your needs. So the answer is different for everyone. And like I mentioned before, at the end, I will give you a very fresh Corona update, and especially related to the schools. About New2NL. My name is Annabeth Vermameren. I am Dutch. I'm married to an American and we have two children, two sons who are now 8 and 10 years old. You see them in the top picture that was in Philadelphia with my in-laws. That was last year, May. We had never expected it would take that long to visit them again. I'm sure a lot of you will share that sentiment. So hopefully things will change and we'll get to see our loved ones again soon. So I help international families find a school for their children. I also write a lot of articles about the Dutch education system, and I've been interviewed in a couple of podcasts. I've recorded videos in which I explain things, and I've been nominated 3 times for the Relocate Awards in the category of Best Family in Education Services. Didn't win, but was still a very great event and very proud that I've come so far. And I started my business about 7.5 years ago. Mainly because I have a lot of international friends and now I'm very interested to meet other families with children. I got a lot of questions about everything, but mainly about education, so I started helping them. My mother has been a teacher for foreign children and later coordinator for foreign adults who all had to learn Dutch. I have lived in Italy. I have studied organizational psychology and I wrote my thesis and I did research about cultural conflicts at work. All the things I'm interested in and that I like doing are coming together in my business. And I'm very happy to give these webinars to inform people who cannot be in the Netherlands at the moment, but still they know how to take the best decisions for their children. And that's really my passion, to inform everyone properly so they know how it works and they make sure that their children are happy in school. So I saw some of you have children at preschool age. It varies a bit per city. In Amsterdam, preschool starts at age 2. Some other places, it's age 2.5. So depending on where you live, it can start sooner or later. There are daycares with and without a preschool program. So that is something to look out for. Preschool used to be free, but that's not the case anymore. So everyone has to pay a fee, but the fee depends on a lot of things. So whether you have a partner or not, if you work and whether your partner works, and what your household income is. So the combined income of you and your partner, if applicable. There's a big range. People with the lowest income, they pay €17.08 per month, and then the higher incomes pay €284.81, and that's the fees for Amsterdam. Every city has their own fee structure, but that's a bit the fees that you have to think of. If both parents work, or if a single parent works, then you can get a tax rebate through the tax office, the Belastingdienst in Dutch. When it's not the case, then you can ask for a subsidy from the municipality. So the amount you pay is roughly the same, but then the subsidy comes from a different area. When you have a tax rebate, then you get a higher rebate for the second or further children of the same family. So that's also interesting to know, and it can make a big difference. Also, the number of hours per week varies a bit per city. In Amsterdam, you get 16 hours per week spread out over a minimum of 3 days. Some preschool organizations have a different structure, so always ask them how that works in that case. And the preschools are open when the primary schools are open, and that's for 40 weeks per year. And then they're closed when the primary school has a school vacation as well. In preschool, they follow a specific program. There are a couple of different programs to choose from. In the end, the difference is not that big. The idea is that they teach the children social skills. There's a lot of children who don't speak Dutch yet, so the teachers are trained to teach Dutch to non-Dutch children. They do a lot of things together as a group, and they follow the same structure as most primary schools do. So they work with symbols and have cards that represent those symbols. So then first in the morning, the teacher hangs those cards somewhere in a way that the children can see it and they know what's going to happen. And that's very important. So for example, they first start with circle time, and they first talk about how many children are there, and more boys or more girls. Some child is sick, so when that child would be there, how many children in total would be there. So in a very playful way, they learn the first principles of math and language. And then maybe they sing some songs together, they talk about the weekend, what they have been doing. Then they have some free time to read a book or make some art projects. Then they go and play outside. Then the teacher reads a book, they sing some songs, and they work a lot with themes. So they the songs and the books and the conversations are all related to that theme. So in that way, they expand their vocabulary. In the primary school, in the first 2 years, they work with the same theme. So the children from preschool, they're already prepared for that. And then they have some fruit snack. Then they do some group activity. And then it's time to go home. So the children know what's happening. It's very clear. It's very structured. And in that way, they really prepare for primary school. Maybe you've heard of a VWE indication. That's indication that you can get at Consultatiebureau, the GGD, where you also get your vaccines. They give a VWE indication to children whose parents are lower educated and who don't really have the means to prepare their children to primary school, or children who have a language delay in their home language, or who already speak two languages or more, and Dutch would be the third or the fourth language. So then in that case, they can give a VWE indication. And it used to have a lot of advantages in the past. That has changed a bit since 2018. So sometimes you find old information, but that's different. It doesn't apply anymore. But with a VWE indication, you sometimes get a lower fee per hour for preschool, and you get priority for the connected primary school. In a lot of places, that can have a big advantage as well, because there's, for example, in Amsterdam, there's a lottery for primary school. So it helps when your child has a VWE indication and goes to the connected preschool. In other cases, if your child doesn't have a VWE indication, then you don't have priority for the primary school. So that's very important to understand that. When your child is 4, then they can go to primary school. There's a choice between international and Dutch school. Well, that choice is very personal. And with my clients, we usually start discussing about that. My recommendation is when a family stays for a short time in the Netherlands, it's often better to choose for international school, especially when the children are older, they have already been in school, especially if they have been in an English-speaking school. So it's a better continuation of their education. It also helps to send your child to international school if you want to be part of the international community. And it's very safe environment in that sense. Everyone belongs to the international community. So you're all in the same boat in the end. And of course, if you can afford it. My experience, there are less and less people who get the money from their employer to pay for international school. So then it can become pretty expensive. Depending on where you live, there are a couple of international schools that you could choose from. Most of them are in Amsterdam area or near The Hague. So in Amsterdam, you have the Amsterdam International Community School called ACE. And they have primary and secondary school. And they are subsidized school. And that's very important to realize. So the Netherlands is one of the few countries in the world to subsidize international education. That means that the government pays for part of the school fees of the children who attend those schools. They are officially only accessible to children who are temporarily in the Netherlands for the work of their parents. So you have to prove that you live in the Netherlands for a short time. Usually, once you're in, you're in. They will not kick you out if you end up staying longer, but they might ask you for a letter from your employer to prove that you will be temporarily in the Netherlands. So that's something to be aware of. Then there are also some private schools. There, the parents have to pay all the fees themselves, or if they're lucky, the employer pays that for them. So the difference is pretty big. So the Amsterdam International Community School, their fees are about 4,500 euros. A bit higher for secondary school. Most private international schools, they start with 16,000, so 16,000 per year per child, or even higher. So that makes a big difference. Then there are also some schools that belong to the country where they originate from, so the French school, the Japanese school in Amsterdam, and in The Hague you also have a French school and a Japanese school, but also a German Indonesian school and some other ones. So there's more choice in terms of languages if you want. And they are subsidized by the country they are related to. In Amsterdam, you also have a couple of schools. So some are subsidized, like the new Amsterdam International Primary School. And then there are some private schools as well. And they have a Japanese kindergarten. So there's a lot of options. Most of those schools have a waiting list. So if you're interested, you should really apply very quickly and hope you will get a place. Don't wait too long. And why would you choose for a Dutch school? Yeah, the reasons are actually opposite of why you would choose for international school. So especially for families who are staying in the Netherlands for longer periods of time, I usually recommend a Dutch school because in that way you fit in better, you integrate more into the Dutch society, you get Dutch friends. Playdates is really a big thing for children. Usually they organize the playdates themselves after school. As a parent, you can of course say yes or no if it works out for you or not, but it's very common that some other children will play at your house or that you have to pick up your child later at their friend's house. So make sure to exchange addresses and phone numbers with their parents or babysitters or whoever is picking them up. But that's really a nice way for your children to get their classmates better and for you to get their parents better. Especially children who are younger, they usually pick up the language very quickly. After a while, you'll see that they will correct you when you try to speak Dutch. And there's a lot of benefits of learning multiple languages. I agree with you that in the world, Dutch is maybe not one of the most important languages to learn. But since you are in the Netherlands, maybe it's a good idea to learn Dutch. You and your children will better understand how things work, what's going on around you, and to make contact with other people nearby. Whereas at the international schools, a lot of the students live pretty far away from the school, so they have to travel by a car or public transport. And it's a bit more difficult to arrange for play dates and gatherings. At Dutch schools, most children live very close by the school. Most of them go on foot or by bike. And the school is really the center of the community. So a lot of children from the same neighborhood go to the same school. And it makes things much easier logistically. Another benefit is that there's a lot of educational philosophies or religions that the schools are based on, so you can choose what type of school would fit your family best. And another not unimportant advantage is that the Dutch schools are almost free. I say almost because the education is free, but the schools ask a parent contribution, which is officially voluntarily, for some extra things. So maybe they hire a dedicated music teacher for the decoration of the classrooms in the school for Sinterklaas. Maybe you've seen it these days, or for Christmas. So they ask some extra contribution for that. Parents who cannot afford that, they don't have to pay, and the school officially cannot oblige them. And often a municipality can also contribute for those parents if they need it. Now, before you send your child to a Dutch school, you of course need to know what the quality is. Maybe you are aware of the PISA OECD survey. They test for science, math and reading among 50-year-olds. So it's high school age. Every 4 years, they survey the students in 56 different countries around the world. And the Netherlands usually scores pretty well among the top 10. You only see for reading that the scores are going down, which is a bit worrying. So the black dots are the Dutch scores and the purple ones are the average of the PISA OECD countries. So that's why the government has been pushing a lot to improve the pleasure in reading and the reading skills. It turns out that especially children who don't speak Dutch at home, that they have more issues with reading, so they are paying more attention and create more funds to support it. So hopefully we will see improving results in the coming years. Then there's the World Economic Forum, and they also do their own research, and they have found that the Netherlands is one of the most competitive economies in Europe and in the world also. And education is a big chunk of that position, among other things, of course. And then there's the Times Higher Education World University Rankings. They rank all universities around the world. There, the Netherlands also performs pretty well. It's important to know that also the universities are funded by the government. The students pay a bit over 2,000 euros per year. And for that, you have very good education, contrary to a lot of other countries where you have some excellent universities and some very poor universities. So here they're all pretty good, but not excellent because they're not as rich as some universities in the US or the UK, for example. There are some universities that specialize in technology or agriculture or languages or exotic cultures or something. So that makes a difference between the universities, but in general, they are all performing very well. So that's important to know when you send your child to a Dutch school, how it works. And here it starts to get a bit more complicated, but I'll try and guide you through it. If you have any questions, then let me know. So a compulsory school attendance, which is called leerplicht in Dutch, starts at age 5. However, most children start school when they turn 4. So it's very common to go to school the day after their 4th birthday. So they start throughout the year. A lot of schools, they have the children start with an orientation or adjustment period. And it really depends on the school and the teacher and your child how long that takes. So usually it's 1 or maybe 2 weeks that they only go to school in the morning and just see how it goes. So even if your child has been for 5 days to daycare, the big school can be very overwhelming for them. And sometimes they're really tired. So make sure to make room in your agenda that you can pick up your child in the afternoon or maybe have someone else pick them up. They will probably need it for the first week. But since they're not obliged to go to school yet, you can also decide to keep your child home every afternoon or maybe every Friday, or when they are a bit tired, just decide to keep them home. That's all okay. Of course, you tell the teacher, but they're not obliged to go to school yet. From the month after their fifth birthday, it's changing a lot. Then they have to go to school, and then the Dutch education law is very strict. So then you cannot take your child anymore on extended vacation, and only when you have a family emergency or an important celebration, you can ask permission to take some days off. So take that very seriously, because you can risk to get a fine and even appear in court if it's really bad, not the first offense. There's an exception for children who are still 5 years old. They may miss 5 hours per week. And if there's a specific reason, they may miss up to 10 hours per week, but then you really have to ask permission. And not many parents know about this exception. Unfortunately, you cannot accumulate those hours, but so you can keep them home for an extra afternoon if you think that's better for them. Most schools, they combine group 1 and 2 in the same class. So that's like kindergarten. The children are called kleuters. So they are in the kleuter class. Group 1 and 2, they learn in a playful way. So they often work with themes, so the same as in the preschools. And they learn a lot of new vocabulary related to the theme, and they go on excursion related to the theme, and they read stories and sing songs. So everything is related to the themes, and that way they really learn to use the words in different contexts. There's also strong focus on social skills, gross and fine motor skills. They play outside, usually 3 times per day. They get gym class, they get music class. So some schools, they have a specialized music teacher, and in other cases, the class teacher gives the music lessons. It's very common for a school to have a specialized gym teacher. And sometimes they also have specialized teachers for maybe science or arts and crafts. So that's also something to consider. So that varies from school to school. And they prepare in group 1 and 2 for reading and writing in a very gradual way. So some children, they're already ready for it. That's fine. If they're not, that's fine too. So the real reading and writing starts in group 3. That's at age 6. And then it goes really fast. So usually before Christmas, all children can read and write. So maybe that's a bit late for you. At age 6, there's been a lot of research that shows that when you push children too early to read and write, that the children losing pleasure in reading, and a higher school dropout rate at a later stage, and a lot of frustration as well. So that's why they teach it more gradually and let it depend on the child when they are ready for it. If you are concerned that your child is not doing well in school, then talk with the teacher about it. That's very important, to keep very close contact to the teacher. Usually there's no homework in the lower classes, but also that is something that varies per school. Some schools don't give any homework, and others, they introduce a bit of homework in the higher classes of primary school, so that the children already get used to it, because in high school there's a lot of homework. And in general, homeschooling is not allowed. There are some exceptions, but before you sign up for any school or show interest in any school, but you actually do want to homeschool, you really have to do your research and make sure that you get all the permissions that you need. It is not easy to do that. And this is also where it starts to get even more complicated. So there's a lot of different types of schools, but actually, almost all schools are funded by the government. So that also applies to the religious schools and to the Montessori or other type of philosophy schools. So that's very important to know. The government has established core objectives, as they call them. So they're the basics for every school, for every year. So those things the schools have to teach, but then they have the freedom to fill in the details themselves, and to add more things on top of the basic curriculum if they want to. So that makes a difference between the schools. There are no two schools that are exactly the same. And then there are a few private schools, really a handful in the whole country, and they don't get state funding. So in that case, the parents have to pay all the fees themselves. The government-funded schools, like you see here on this slide, there's different types of them as well. So you have schools that call themselves openbaar, And that means that they are funded and run by an independent foundation that is originally set up by the government. They are always non-religious, but they do teach about all world religions, but in a neutral way. So the same way they teach, for example, history or geography. Then there are some schools that are bijzonder, which translates to special, and they are run by their own board. And usually that's a group of parents that set up the school or foundation. But remember, they're still state funded. So they have a bit more freedom to decide their own things. But in the end, they have to adhere to all the requirements of the government and they get the funding from the government. Now, a lot of those special schools, they are religious. So Catholic, Protestant or generic Christian, which is a bit of a mixture of Catholic and Protestant usually. There's also some Muslim or Jewish schools, some Hindu schools. So a lot of religions are covered. It is important to know that for the Christian schools, most of them have been established a long time ago when religion was still very important in the Netherlands. So most of them are not really religious anymore. So usually they don't go to church, they don't pray, they don't say grace, but maybe they sing some songs that have some kind of morale, or they maybe read from the Bible and then discuss how that story relates to current day affairs. It really varies from school to school. So that's something to ask the principal. On your website, it says you're a religious school. How does that show in practice? So don't disregard them right away when you're not religious, because maybe they don't do anything and they're a very good school for you. There's also some schools that are based on educational philosophy, so like Montessori or Dalton or Waldorf or Jennerplan. We talk about them in a minute. And to make it even more complicated, there's also a lot of crossovers possible. So you also have schools that are openbaar and Montessori, or for example, Protestant and Dalton. So a lot of combinations. And then there are schools in Dutch, you say speciaal onderwijs, and that translates to special needs. So a lot of things have changed in this area as well. But currently, the regular schools first have to try to accommodate a child who has some special needs. And if the issues are too severe or too complicated, then they might be referred to a dedicated special needs school. And there they have smaller classes and specialized teachers and therapists and experts on campus to support those children. And it depends a bit on the kind of special needs, but in many cases they follow the same basic curriculum as the regular schools. And it's also common that after a few years at the special needs school, the children change to a regular school or the other way around. So if you think your child might need a special needs school, then you should start talking with the regular school early on and arrange the best arrangement for them and make sure that your child gets the support they need. Different philosophies. I will start with Montessori. That's the most common philosophy. At least a lot of international parents are familiar with that. When I lived in Italy, I expected to find a lot of Montessori schools there because Maria Montessori came from Italy. That's not really the case, though. Maria Montessori lived in the Netherlands and she set up the first Montessori schools here. She also died in the Netherlands. The last years of her life, she has been very active here. The motto of Montessori schools is help me to do it myself. So independency is very important. Some parents think that it means that the children can do whatever they want to. That is not the case. Remember the core objectives that the schools have to adhere to, but they get more freedom to do the things the way they want to do it. So they get a week schedule and it says, okay, this week you have to do 5 times math and 5 times reading and twice drama and so on. And then a child can decide when they're going to do what. And when they're done, they have to sign it off. So the teacher can check that indeed they have done what they're supposed to do. But that gives them the freedom to plan their work themselves. And if they don't feel like doing math on Monday, for example, then they're stuck with that for the rest of their week. But that is their decision, their responsibility. And taking your responsibility is very important as well in Montessori schools. Another feature of Montessori schools is that they combine 3 age groups in the same class. So the children learn from each other, they help each other, and they learn to experiment with how is it to like to be the youngest of the class, and then in the middle group, and then in the older group. You will look at the other children in a different way, and they will look at you in a different way when you get older. So your social position changes all the time, and it's something they get to experience as well. And they work with a lot of materials. So like you see in the picture, this girl is training her fine motor skills. So every material connects with the developmental phase that the child finds themselves in. And in that way, they learn and grow. And they have to choose the materials themselves and put them back in a proper way that the next child can work with them again. So also here, this responsibility of taking care of your environment is very important. And there are lots of more things to tell about Montessori, but because of the time, we move on to Dalton. The Dalton philosophy was created by Helen Parkhurst from the US. There's a lot of similarities between Dalton and Montessori, and the reason is that Maria Montessori and Helen Parkhurst used to work together. And then they got a disagreement and Helen Parkhurst started her own schools. Some of the differences are that where Montessori combines three age groups in one class, in Dalton there's just one age group in the same class, with an exception of group one and two that are usually combined in almost all schools. But so from group three onwards, they only have one age group. Usually in Dalton schools in the morning, the children work by themselves on Dutch language and math. And in the afternoon, they work together in group projects for history, geography, biology, and those kind of subjects. So they work a lot with projects. They learn to set their own deadlines and their own learning goals. And they change the composition of the groups the whole time so that you learn to work together with children who are maybe not your friends. So like in Montessori, they work with a week schedule, but here the planning is even more important. So they really have to plan what task they're going to do on which day, and when they are finished they have to color it with the color of the corresponding day. So every day has a different color, so in the end of the week the teacher can check, so oh, you were planning on finishing this on Monday but you only finished on Thursday, what happened? So not to punish them but to make them aware that something went wrong in their planning and how could they improve it next week. So that is very Dalton. Then the next philosophy is Janaplan, and Janaplan was founded by Peter Peterson from Eastern Germany. And in Janaplan education, the community plays a very important role. And like Montessori, they combine three age groups in the same class, but the reason behind it is a little different, because Peter Peterson thought that it's a bit artificial to only be with children of the same age in your class, because in the rest of your community, it's always age groups that are combined. So for that reason, there are also three age groups in Janaplan class. And they do a lot of things together with the whole class or with the whole school. They have a lot of celebrations together. World orientation plays an important role. So they learn a lot of things about their community, but also about other cultures and other countries. And in their celebrations, they often use elements from different cultures, so that while celebrating, they learn a lot of things about the rest of the world. It's also very common that they have, for example, a week closure celebration. So on Friday afternoon, one or two classes, they've made a performance. Maybe they have made a song or they perform a dance for the rest of the classes of the school. And then next week, there's some other groups that give a performance. So in this way, the children really get to know each other and the other teachers, and they feel like a big community. The next philosophy I want to talk about is Waldorf, or some people know it as Steiner schools, named after Rudolf Steiner from Austria. And that you say, Freie School. This philosophy is more different compared to the other philosophies. So either you like it a lot or not so much. There's not really a gray area in between. So in Waldorf education, nature plays a very important role. They celebrate the change of seasons. They work a lot with natural materials like wood and wool and felt. And they often celebrate events that are sometimes related to the Bible, especially the First Testament. They're not really a religious school, but more like spiritual. And they often celebrate with the whole school, including the parents, so the community plays a very important role. They also work a lot with art and sort of dance, eurythmy. It's called sort of self-expression dance. You can see in the picture how they perform. Usually the teacher stays with the same class for multiple years. So often you have a teacher for the first 2 years and then another teacher that stays with the same class maybe until the end of primary school, or maybe they have one teacher for the first 3 years and then another teacher for the last 3 years. And in that way, they really get to know each other very well. They do a lot of things together. So they're very different from Montessori in that sense that they don't do many things independently in Waldorf schools. And they don't use a lot of textbooks usually. They learn a lot of things through poems and stories and fables and recitals and songs. So remember, they have the same core objectives, but the way they teach them is very different. So there's a lot more to talk about, but for now I'll leave it here. On my website, you can find a video in which I explain the philosophies more into detail. So maybe that would help too if you're interested. Now we'll talk about tests. So maybe you've heard about the TITO test. A lot of things have changed in that area, so it could be that what you've heard is not applicable anymore. What still is the same, that towards the end of group 8, which is the last year of primary school, the children are usually 12 by then. And then in the end of January, beginning of February, the teacher of group 8 gives a recommendation for secondary school. In the next slides, I'll show you what types of secondary education we're talking about. The teacher looks at the child's test results, especially from group 6 onwards, but also their attitude, their interests, their motivation, their study skills. So they look at the child as a whole, and then they give their advice. And then in April, so a few months later, the children take the end test, and there are five organizations that have been approved by the government to make this test. So CITO is one of them, but it's the most famous one. So a lot of people call it CITO test, but it's not always the case. In this test, they test for Dutch language, math, and study skills. And study skills, they have to interpret a graph or use an outside source and answer some questions about that, of course, at the level of 12-year-olds. And optional is world orientation. World orientation is a combination of history, geography, biology, and world religions. This is optional because some very religious schools have complained about the questions about other religions. So if a school is not testing for world orientation, it could mean that they're very religious. So you should check out if that's the case and if that would work for you or not. If the test results are higher than the teacher's advice, then the advice might be higher. So then the child can go to a higher level of secondary education. If the test results are lower, then the recommendation of the teacher stays. So the teacher is leading in this sense because they know the child better than the test, because it's only moment in time. All schools are obliged to take part in this test. So in some countries, for example, in Montessori schools, they don't take tests, but that is not the case in the Netherlands. All schools are obliged to take part. But the schools may choose which type of test they use, and that applies to all the students. So there are some differences between a CITO and other tests. Then there's the pupil monitor system. And those are the tests that the students take from group 2 or group 3 onwards, so usually twice per year. And those tests measure their progress. You don't need to stress over those tests because the students don't need to prepare for that. They don't need to study anything for those tests. But it is just to see if they develop in the way they should. And if not, maybe they need some extra support. Or maybe they just had a bad day and didn't sleep well and were not really concentrated. That's also fine. So nothing really happens based on these tests only. So they cannot repeat or skip a year just because they performed good or bad in those tests. But it's an indication if a child might need extra support or not. And if the whole class performs poorly, then maybe the teacher didn't explain it well. So in a way, it's also a test for the teacher. So don't stress over that when your child is only 5 or 6 years old, because that's really not needed. You can find those test results on websites that you can access publicly. I want to warn you though, because you shouldn't compare a school just based on their test results. There are a few things to take into consideration first. So a lot of things could change between now and the time that your child is 12. And those results that you see, the most recent ones are from not last April because of Corona. They canceled all the tests. So they're from last year, May. So a lot of things can change. So that is something to be aware of too. And you also have to understand what the composition of the population is. So if there's a lot of parents who are maybe lower educated and don't speak Dutch, they maybe don't read a lot of books with their children, maybe they don't take them a lot to museums, they don't have a strong vocabulary. In those cases, they start school with not so much basic knowledge, and the schools have to teach them a lot of those basics in school. And it's very different from a family where they speak Dutch at home, the parents have been in university, they do a lot of things with their children, maybe they pay for a private tutor or things like that. You cannot compare those families like for like. So what they do on this website is you see this green dot, and that is the score of this particular school. And they relate it to the schools that have a similar population. So that is the black bar that you see. So in this case, the school scored consistently above what was expected from them, so based on their population. So then you know they did a lot of things well. But it can also be that a school maybe has a lower score, but they score much higher than that was expected from them. So the added value of that school is much higher than when the children already started with high basic level. So you really have to dig deeper into those tables and graphs to understand what's happening here. And then there's another website called Alle Cijfers, and there you can see the different high school advices. You can also see them on School op de Kaart, but they've changed the website and now they don't tell you anymore how big the class is, or the group 8 class in this case. And it really changes a lot if maybe you have 60 children in group 8 and one or two maybe have a lower IQ or some learning disabilities, then the percentage of children with a lower test result is much smaller compared to when there's only 15 children in group 8 and one or two of them have learning issues or a lower IQ. So you really need to know the absolute numbers as well. So that's why I use Alle Cijfers for that. And there you can see in this pie chart what the teacher recommendation was. Yeah, and then we come across a lot of acronyms. So I'll briefly guide you through those. I've also made a video about secondary school education. So there I'll explain a bit more into detail what they all mean. VMBO is vocational education and it takes 4 years. So you see in the left pink rectangle. And after that, you could go to MBO, which is vocational education, where you really learn for a specific job. In the next slide, I'll show you what kind of jobs you can think of. HAVO is senior general secondary education, and that takes 5 years. So that's more generic. And that leads to HBO, which is University of Applied Sciences. So in the Netherlands, we make a distinction between University of Applied Sciences, so HBO, and Research University, which is called University. So that is probably also different from what you're used to. And then the VWO track takes 6 years, and that is pre-university, so Research University education. A lot of secondary schools have a mixed level bridge class, or brugklas in Dutch, in the first year, and sometimes also in the first 2 years. So then they combine students from different levels, and then after that, you can choose which is the best matching level. You see those arrows there, and that means that from one level, you can move up to the next level. So for example, after when you have your diploma for VMBO, you can go to the fourth year of HAVO. And with your diploma of HAVO, you can go to the fifth year of VWO. You can also do MBO, so the vocational education, and then go to HBO, the University of Applied Sciences, or do your bachelor at HBO and your master at university. So there's a lot of different options. So some international parents, they think that once you get the MBO advice, that you're stuck for the rest of your life at that level. That is absolutely not the case. But it's very important to realize that you need to have a diploma in the Netherlands. And it's really important to at least have a diploma for something. So it's better to have a diploma at a lower level than go to university and then drop out because it's too difficult, because then you have nothing. And the MBO diplomas, they are very specialized, and they really prepare the students for the job market. So they become very qualified people in different sectors. I'll show you in a minute which sectors they are. Compared to the OECD average that we were talking about earlier, more Dutch people hold a university degree than average. So that's also a good thing. Another thing to really take into consideration is the judgment of the inspection. And I would say that's even more important than the test result. So the inspection, they check a school every 4 years. They have a very long checklist, and they have to see if the results are okay, but also the maintenance of the building. Is it hygienic? How is the teacher turnover? Do they teach the minimum amount of hours that are required by the government? Do they have a good playground? Do they often play outside? Do they make use of the teaching time in an efficient way? So they test for a lot of different things. They rate the schools by means of a traffic light system. So when it's green, then everything is okay. If it's orange, then they found some issues. And if it's red, then the school is in serious trouble. So when a school has received a red rating, it can even mean that they get a fine. And maybe if it really stays as bad, then they risk to be closed. So that is a very serious thing. So on the website of the school inspection, you can find all the reports. They are only in Dutch, unfortunately. But for my clients, always read through that to see if there's something alerting or something they do really well. That's also important to know, of course. So when you see basistoezicht, that means that they have a green rating and everything is okay. And if there's a different word, then something has happened there. So that would raise a red flag, and then you have to figure out what was the problem. Have they improved since? So in this particular school, you see that they got some extra audits and some support and guidance from the school board and the municipality. And then they managed to improve again, and then they have green light again. So they can still change, but it means they had some issues. So have they improved it enough for your taste? These are the professions I was talking about. With MBO, of course, there are many more professions, but just to give you an idea, assistant, secretary, security officer, office employee, hairdresser, nurse, childminder. So they're all vocational professions, and they all get a special diploma, which really means a lot. Then HBO, so also called Hogeschool or University of Applied Sciences. A lot of teachers have HBO diploma. Also accountant, manager, team leader, banker, architect, engineer. So with in Dutch, you get the title ING. Art director, journalist, translator, real estate agent, advisor, consultant, midwife, artist, pilot. So a lot of business professions. The people have studied HBO. So a lot of other professions as well. When you look at people who have a university degree, they usually work as a specialist or an expert. So maybe a lawyer or psychologist, doctor, surgeon, a researcher, notary, professor. And also here's engineer, because you get a different title when you are engineer at the university level, but it depends on what type of engineering you've studied. The same applies to, for example, nurse. So you can become a nurse by studying MBO, but there's also a nursing study at HBO, and then you get more management responsibilities. So a lot of professions, there's different levels of study and then also different levels in your job. So hopefully this gives an idea. There are many more options as well, of course. So then you know a bit where your child's school will lead to in the end. Another thing I want to address is the role of parents in a Dutch school. So I often get the question from international parents, yes, I don't speak Dutch. I'm not sure if I should send my child to a Dutch school. I cannot really help them. So keep in mind that your child will, especially in the beginning, not get much homework or nothing at all. And if they get homework, it's homework for the child and not for the parents. So your role is more to facilitate your child, remind them that they have homework, ask what they have to do, talk about those concepts in your own language, and they will translate it into Dutch. So it's very important that you keep on speaking your own language, that they really get very broad vocabulary, they understand what difficult concepts mean, and they will build on that. So don't try and speak Dutch to your child if you are not a confident speaker. They often need help from parents. It's very nice for you as well, because in that way you understand better what's going on. You get to know your child's classmates and their parents and the teacher better. So if there's an issue, you can more easily discuss about it with the teacher because you've met each other already a couple of times. So that's always good. And you know better how it works and ask your questions. So some of the tasks that you really need to speak Dutch for, so for example, a parent who helps reading in group 3, yeah, then you of course need to speak Dutch. But maybe they also need parents to accompany their children on a school trip, and there's more children who speak English and you could accompany them. Or maybe help sort the books in the library, or help the children to cross over the roads safely. So there's a lot of things you could do without speaking too much Dutch, and it will be really appreciated. 2 or 3 times per year, you will be invited for a so-called 10-minute meeting. Usually it's a bit longer than 10 minutes, but the idea is it's a short meeting. And the teacher will give you an update about your child's progress. So usually they get a report 2 or 3 times per year, and they will discuss the results, not only for the subjects, but also for their behavior and their emotional well-being. So they will talk about a lot of things that they see from your child. And then they will also ask your opinion, and you can ask your questions as well. So if you are concerned or if you want to know something, just ask. But if there's something else that you're worried about and 10-minute meeting is still far away, then it's better to make an appointment with the teacher to talk about it. And in general, don't keep those things to yourself. Don't let it escalate. So if you have a question or concern, talk about it right away with the person you are dealing with. So is there a problem with the teacher? Talk with the teacher. Don't go immediately to the principal, because that's not the way it works in the Netherlands generally. Tell in a neutral way what you've heard or what you have seen or what you think. Also teach you for their point of view and try and solve it. So a lot of things are based on a misunderstanding or miscommunication, so it's easy to solve, but you have to address it first. If you really cannot solve it with the teacher, then you might talk to the principal or file an official complaint, but don't take that too lightly. So contact with the teacher is very important. Unfortunately, because of Corona, it's a bit more difficult nowadays, but make sure to have this contact still in different ways. So maybe by email or online meeting or something. The question I get asked a lot is what makes a good school? Yeah, that really depends on a lot of different things. So I cannot answer that question easily. So it depends on what is important for you. So maybe you find it important that the school spends a lot of time on music or science, or when they have a good playground, or when they have an international community, or when they teach according to a philosophy, or when they are religious. There's a lot of different things that decide if a school is good for you or not. So it's very important to talk with other parents about their opinion about the school, but also if they would recommend it to your family, because there's often a difference in those two things. Another good idea is to go to school at pickup time and then observe how the parents interact with each other. So are they very busy on their mobile phones, or do they talk a lot together? Also, this has changed a bit because of COVID, of course, but usually parents talk a lot with each other, they arrange things, they help out each other. But some other schools, you see that much less. So maybe that means they don't really have a lot of contact between the parents. So is that important to you or not? You can also observe how the children come out. So do they wait for the teacher to tell them, okay, we now go out, or do they just run outside? How do the children interact with the teachers, and how do the teachers interact with the parents? So what is your opinion about what you see? Do you think it's a good match? Do you think that your child would become friends with the children that you see? But also very important, do you think that you would become friends with the parents that you see? Because you will spend a lot of time there as well, and you will have to do a lot of things together with the other parents. So do you feel a match? And who is picking up the children? Is it mainly the parents, or nannies, or au pairs, or grandparents, or do they go to after school care? So that also tells you a lot about the population. And do you feel comfortable with what you see? You can find the pickup times at the school's website, because they can decide their own hours. The government has set a minimum number of hours that the schools have to teach, and they can decide how they divide it over the week. Most schools, they start between 8:30 and 9 in the morning, and then they finish around 3:15 to 3:15 maybe. A lot of schools are closed on Wednesday afternoon, so they finish between 12 and 1 at some point. So Wednesday afternoon is the time that a lot of children have play dates and birthday parties, and they go to sports clubs and music schools. So it's a very social active day. But you have to arrange those things yourself usually. And that's where knowing other parents comes in handy, because a lot of parents help out each other. So it's very common that, for example, I take some friends to soccer practice, and then their friends' parents pick them up, or next week they take turns. So you help out each other a lot in that way. But do you get a good feeling about all those things when you look at the school and at the children and the teachers and the parents? So it's very, very personal decision. So if someone says this is a good school, you should always ask them, why do you think that? And do you also think it's a good school for my family? I'm not sure if some of you have children who are already 6 or older. So I'll briefly mention how that works. It depends a bit on the city. So in most places, when children are 6 and older and don't speak Dutch, they have to go to a newcomer class first. And that's a specialized class for children who have to learn Dutch still, and then they move to a regular school. So in general, it takes 1 year, but also depending on the child's progress. And usually they can move up to the next grade afterwards, but it also depends how the child is doing and what they have missed. In some cities like Utrecht and Almere, the newcomer class starts at age 4, so earlier than in other places, so that's also something to consider. There are some schools that are dedicated newcomer class, and other schools are a regular school and have in-house class for newcomers. So that also makes a difference. Then there is also different newcomer class for children who are secondary school age, so from age 12 to 18. And maybe you've heard of KOP class, and that's an additional year after primary school. So for students who are very motivated and usually also good at math and the other subjects, but because of their lack of Dutch language, they got a lower advice for secondary school. So they get 1 year very intensive Dutch classes to end up with a higher advice. Every city also arranges that in a bit different way, so it's always good to research into that as well. The next steps that you have to take, so make an appointment to visit the schools. Unfortunately, because of COVID, adults are not allowed in schools anymore. So some appointments, some school visits are online, or sometimes you may go meet the principal at the playground and walk around the school. So yeah, ask how they have arranged those things. It's good to visit multiple schools so you can get a feel for them. And it's a bit the same as buying a house. Maybe the pictures of Vanda are all very fancy, looks very interesting. But when you set 1 foot inside, maybe you get the feeling it's not for me. It's a bit the same with schools. So most schools, they organize information mornings, pre-COVID that is, and then to sign up for those info sessions. So you usually cannot get a private tour because they don't have the capacity to guide a lot of parents around privately. ask them a lot of questions. For all people who have signed up for this webinar, I'll send them a checklist with questions that they can ask. So that also helps in your school search. You have to sign up for those info sessions. So sometimes they limit the number of people so they don't disturb the children too much. And so when you sign up, then also ask them for some time afterwards to ask your questions in English. A lot of schools only have info sessions in Dutch. Some have a separate session in English. I'll also ask how that works. But especially in the bigger cities, it's very common that there's more parents who speak English and then they answer those questions for the English-speaking parents as well. Don't expect that they give the session only in English, because there's also parents who don't speak English and they go to Dutch schools, so you cannot disadvantage them. And it's very important to visit multiple schools to get a feel for them, because they're all very different. So look around closely, observe the children. Do they look happy? Do they look engaged? How do you view the teachers? I always check the names of the children to see, are they mainly Dutch names or a lot of international sounding names? The artwork, is it only the perfect examples of art, or also some that have some kind of mistakes that they just put on display? That also tells you a lot about the schools. Yes, promised, I'll give you a corona update. So this evening there was a press conference and they said that things are going in the right direction, but we are not there yet. So the schools have been open since mid-May. They were closed since mid-March. In the beginning, they only opened part-time, so for half classes at a time. But after 3 weeks, when it went well, they opened full-time. And they have been open since. Of course, there was summer vacation in between. It is going pretty well, so they took some extra measures. So like you see in the right picture, there's one-way traffic. You have to walk a certain path. Parents are not allowed in the school, which feels still very strange to me. But yeah, that's the way it is. Children have to wash their hands very regularly. And a lot of school-wide events have been cancelled and school trips cancelled and celebrations cancelled. But at least school has been able to take place. It happens a lot that a teacher tests positive, or they have to wait for their test, or they have been in touch with someone who tested positive and then they have to quarantine. So then they teach online. So during the first lockdown, they had online teaching as well, which worked well in a lot of ways, but for a social-emotional level for the children, it has been not very good for everyone. So they really try to keep the schools open as much as possible, but they have to adjust a lot. So also at some point I had one child who had to go to school, another one had to study from home, and now the books that they have to take with them. So it requests a lot of flexibility and adjustments from the teacher, the children, but also the parents. In secondary school, the rules are a bit more strict. Like you see in the left picture, the students have to wear face masks in common areas. So when they sit down in the classroom, they can take them off. When it's break time, they have to walk through, for example, the art room, then they have to put the face masks on again. So previously, the students had to change classes all the time and the teachers stayed in their own classroom. But now, since COVID, the teachers try to meet the students in their classroom as much as possible. So there's less traffic within the school. But of course, for some classes like art and science and sports, that's not really possible. So then the students have to change. In general, the schools are still open. And this evening, they didn't say anything about the school. So it will stay the way it is. To give you a short update about the other things. So for the past 2 weeks, the museums and zoos and swimming pools have been closed, but they can open again from Thursday morning. The restaurants and bars, unfortunately, are still closed. People are encouraged to work from home as much as possible. All events have been cancelled, but especially the adults that feel those measures. For children, not so much has changed, so they still can go to school. The sports clubs are still open, but parents are not allowed at the sports fields or facilities, which also means that they cannot have games anymore against other clubs, but they can still have games against a team of the same club. So that doesn't create as much traffic, but the children can still play their sports, which is also very important for their well-being and development, health, and a lot of other things. So luckily, those things still can take place. And hopefully, we'll continue to go in the right direction and we'll become better again. Yeah, if you want more information about corona developments related to education, then let me know. I would like to talk with you about a special offer that I want to make. I offer different packages that you can find on my website and the families page. If you book the all-inclusive package that consists of a 1.5-hour video call, follow-up email with a lot of information, a detailed report about the schools of your interest, I will arrange the school visits and sign you up for the information sessions. I help you with the application form, which is usually in Dutch for the Dutch schools. I'll give you access to a lot of resources. Most of them you can find on my website, but others are against payment, so I'll give them to you as well. A normal price is 445 euros, but when you make booking within 7 days from now, then you will get 10% discount. The call itself does not need to take place within the next 7 days, but importance is that you make the booking within 7 days. So that was the presentation. There's a lot more to talk about. I can imagine you still have many questions. Back to the screen that you can see me again. I hope things are more clear now. If not, let me know. If you have a question afterwards that you prefer to ask by email, that's also fine. Or if when you book a call, you can, of course, ask all the other questions that you have. I will go through the questions here. So thank you very much. Yeah, about the school vacations, how that works. Yeah, that's true. I didn't mention that. It's also very different than you're used to, probably. In the Netherlands, the summer vacation lasts 6 weeks. And then after every 6 or 7 weeks of school, you have 1 or 2 weeks of vacation again. Then to make it more complicated, even the Netherlands has been divided in three regions, and they all go on summer vacation 1 week after the other to spread out the holiday traffic. So yeah, it's very hard to say in advance when the summer vacation will start. And then after the 6 weeks of summer vacation, the children go 6 or 7 weeks to school, and then there's 1 week of autumn vacation. And then there's again 6 or 7 weeks of school, and then it's 2 weeks of Christmas break, and so on through the whole year. So the children have time to recharge their batteries and rest and then be fresh for the next term. If you move to the Netherlands throughout the year, that's usually not a problem. You don't need to wait to the beginning of the school year. Your children can just start right away. Currently, all people from 12 years and older, they have to go into quarantine for 10 days first when they arrive. Children don't have to go into quarantine, but then, yeah, how does your child get at school on their first school day when you're not there? So in practice, children start 2 weeks later, usually. Yeah, I hope that answers your question. And remember that outside of the school vacations, you cannot take off unless you have a very important reason. So in total, there are 40 weeks of school and 12 weeks of vacation spread out over the year. About the transition from group 2 to group 3, that's also a very specific Dutch situation. So remember that most children start the day after their fourth birthday, so they start throughout the year. And most schools use the 1st of January as the cutoff date for the transition from group 2 to group 3. But it doesn't only depend on the date of birth, but also how mature they are, if they're ready for reading and writing, or if they're very playful and they just need to be a child a bit longer. The teachers of group 1 and 2, they discuss with the parents what they think would be the best next group for the year after. And children who are born before the 1st of January, they usually stay less than 2 years in group one and two. Children born after the 1st of January usually stay more than 2 years. There's no stigma on staying longer in kindergarten or repeating a year. They really look at the child, what's needed for them, how they flourish, and also for their self-esteem. So if your child is born between, let's say, mid-October and mid-January, that's a bit of a gray area. So then you will have some discussions with the teacher throughout the year to see when they're ready for group three. So you're already prepared for that. Some schools use the 1st of October as a cutoff date, so then the story becomes different again. So it's very depending on the school. Question, yeah, if a child has dyslexia, what would you advise then? Yes, actually one of the first tests they take in group two is rhyming. And it turns out that children who have difficulty with rhyming could mean that they will show that they have dyslexia later on. So that's why they start with that test. So if they completely don't understand the concept of rhyming, that might mean, of course, not necessarily, but then the teacher will watch that more closely. A school has an eBayer, they call it. It's a kind of school mentor who assists the teachers and can take some tests with the students. So they can also check for dyslexia, or if they don't have the expertise and knowledge themselves, they can also ask external agency to take a dyslexia test. Usually they only start with taking the test if a child has shown some low results over the past 2 years, I think. I'm not completely sure, so it's not immediately that they will take that test. For some schools, it's also a bit difficult to understand, does a child show reading issues because they are bilingual or multilingual? So is it a issue of speaking multiple languages, or do they have reading issues? Especially international parents often have those questions. So make sure to talk about that, because not all schools have experience with children who speak other languages at home. And does a child have difficulty with writing in their home language as well as in Dutch, or only one of the languages? That also tells you a lot about what the issue could be. But like with a lot of other things, stay on top of it. And you could also decide to have external party test your child for dyslexia or other things if you have other concerns, or if you have to pay those tests yourself. Then sometimes your insurance could give you some money back, so also check with your insurance. But yeah, make sure that if you have concerns in that area, to talk about it and to start trying and solve it, or get your child tested as soon as possible, so that you can take the necessary steps and, of course, also involve the teacher in that. So I hope that helps. I don't see any new questions come in, so I'll finish here. It's also past 10 already, so I can imagine you are tired by now. It's a lot of information. I hope I've made it a bit more clear to you, that you feel more confident now taking the right decisions for your children. And like I said, if you have any questions, let me know. I'm there for you. Oh, sorry. I just got a question about the lottery. I assume you live in Amsterdam then. We didn't talk about that specifically, but some cities like Amsterdam and Haarlem, for example, and The Hague have a lottery. And in most cases, you have to apply when your child is 3 years old. This question is about a child who is indeed 3 years old and they've missed a lottery. Yeah, that's a bit of a complicated situation, because a lot of schools are already full after the lottery. When they're full, they're full. So maybe a child will move over time and they can make place for your child. But usually they don't have a waiting list, so you cannot really count on that. So what you should do then is contact the schools of your interest one by one and ask if they still have a place. Hopefully you're lucky. They don't have to take your child. So even if the school is across from your house, if they're full, they're full. And then keep on contacting them every now and then and just ask if anything has changed and if they can offer a place now. Hopefully you will be lucky. Yeah, don't wait too long and start to ask them now. Okay, I think that was really the last question. Okay, then I wish you all a very good night, or when you are in the US, there are some people in the US as well, I see. Enjoy the rest of your day. We'll be in touch. Bye bye.